at Work Careers in Microfinance.
Thank you.
I'm going to tell you a little bit about our presenters today, but first I would like to just again welcome you to today's presentation. Today's webinar is actually being sponsored by Georgetown Alumni Association and the Alumni Career Services Office. My name is Maisha Thorpe, and I am here at Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. To begin, I'd like to just share a few housekeeping tips with you and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded, and I will notify everyone after today's presentation about how to access the archive presentation, should you wish to join and re-listen again. There are two audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers. You don't particularly need a headset for that, if you just prefer. You can also dial in to the conference bridge number that was provided in your reminder email. One quick reminder is that if you have quite a few other screens open, so if you're in several internet browsers or in other platforms on your computer screen, it may affect your audio quality. If you're having that problem, I highly recommend that you just dial into the conference bridge or close some of the applications you have open. For today's presentation, questions are welcome. We will have a Q&A session. You'll need to type in your questions. You can do that throughout the session or at the end when we get to that time. The presenters today are planning to answer as many questions as time allows us, and when we get to that point in the presentation, we will definitely welcome all your questions. If you're having any technical difficulties, I definitely recommend you submitting those to me via the chat area on your computer screen if that is possible, just so that you're aware I'm unable to check email or take phone calls during this presentation. While technical difficulties are disappointing, we try to mitigate all of the issues that can arise, but in the event that we experience any technical difficulties, just like for everyone to know that we will attempt to resolve them as soon as possible. If we're unable to do that within 5 to 10 minutes, we will cancel the session and contact you within an hour to let you know our ability to reschedule the session. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our wonderful presenters today. Joan Trant is the Executive Director of the International Association of Microfinance Investors. And Joan is a graduate of Columbia University's Graduate School of Business Executive Level Nonprofit Management Certificate Program. She holds a bachelor's degree from Georgetown University, where she graduated magna cum laude with a Spanish major and business administration minor, concentration in Latin American Studies. She is based in New York City. Following Joan today is Deborah Drake, who works with ACCION International. And she is currently the program manager investing in inclusive finance of the Center for Financial Inclusion at ACCION International. She manages also the Council of Microfinance Equity Funds, and she is a board member at the Small Enterprise and Promotion Network. She is also a graduate of Georgetown and holds an MBA from Babson College. And last but not least is Mary Ellen Iskenderian, and she is the president and CEO of Women's World Banking, the world's largest network of microfinance institutions and banks. And she joined this organization in 2006, and has more than 20 years of experience in building global financial systems throughout the developing world. She currently sits on the advisory board of the Dignity Fund, Kiva, and Trickle Up, as well as the board of directors of ASA Foundation. She is a member of the Women's Leadership Board at Harvard University, and she holds an MBA from the Yale School of Management and a Bachelor of Science in International Economics from Georgetown University. And we're very excited to have all three of these alumni with us today, and I want to turn it over to Joan to present her piece with us.
Very good. Okay, I hope everyone can see my screen.
Almost. There we go.
Yeah, there we go.
Okay. Well, thank you to everyone who signed on today. Thank you, Maisha and Deborah and Mary Ellen. I thought that what we could do would be do a quick run through the International Association of Microfinance Investors activities so you have a sense of what our particular involvement in microfinance is, and then I'll speak a little bit about what my career path was that led me to being executive director here. I think Deborah and Mary Ellen will do the same thing, and then we'll welcome your comments. So I'm going to go quite quickly through these screens. As you can see, our mission is to support the international microfinance investing community. We wanted to help investors leverage their capital more effectively so that we can have more capital flowing into microfinance and reaching more of the financially excluded. And we do that through four key areas of activity. The first thing that we've tried to do, and it's a work in progress, is gathering all of that information that's out there in cyberspace and in reports and research pieces and post them on IAMFI's website so that investors have a one-stop portal for accessing timely information on the microfinance industry as it relates to investing. So there's a lot of information out there for donors and microfinance institutions actually doing lending in the field to micro borrowers. We're really providing the commercial investment information portal. There's a lot we don't know about investing yet. Investors have really only seriously been in this market for the past 10 years, so it's a nascent industry, and we're conducting proprietary research on investment-related topics. We do a lot of virtual and in-person educational and networking events. Our investors are all over the world, so we do a lot of webinars and teleconferences, but we also try to bring small groups of people together so that they can really share kind of what's going on in the industry from their perspective. And since we are trying to build this industry, make it more accessible to investors, make it more transparent, more standardized, IAMFI conducts outreach to all industry influencers to try to build a more enabling environment for microfinance investing. If you think about investors, you think a lot about the individual who's putting money into microfinance. I'm sorry to say that right now, from the individual standpoint, less than 0.1% of SRMI money is going into microfinance, so investors at this point are still largely institutional, but they can either choose to direct straight their assets straight to microfinance banks in country, or they can invest through a growing array of microfinance investment vehicles that will place their money for them. So IAMFI seeks to serve the people who are actually providing the funds or the institutions providing the funds, the general partners like those microfinance investment vehicles that are making the investments, and also service providers like lawyers and brokers and wealth advisors who are supporting investors. I'm not going to go through what our services are. You can look at that later when you get copies of the presentations or go online at www.iamfi.com. But I do want to jump ahead and show you two other resources. I've posted here several online job boards that focus on development careers in general, and some have a lot of postings on microfinance. And I've also attached IAMFI's useful links URL. I can happily say that ACCION and Women's World Banking are also linked through IAMFI's useful links, so you'll find a lot of other links to microfinance organizations. So since we're going to hold questions until Q&A, I'll just jump right into how I ended up at IAMFI. I graduated from Georgetown. I got a job at Citibank doing international banking, and very quickly got transferred to Madrid, where Citibank was in the process of buying a bank. And so that kind of helped me build my financial skills. I came back to New York and began doing private banking for Mexican and Argentine clients, and that brought me back into my first love, which was Latin America. And I basically experienced the boom and bust cycles in both countries during the Salinas de Gortari years in Mexico and the Carlos Menem administration in Argentina. And what I was able to observe was that when the wealthy were getting much wealthier, the poor were not having these great increases in quality of life or ability to save and change their living standards. And when the bust cycle hit, one of the first things that got cut in the austerity budgets were the already inadequate social programs. So it made me think I needed to do something else with my career. And I heard about a little organization called the Resource Foundation that was trying to support communities in Latin America by working with on-the-ground non-governmental organizations or NGOs. So I joined that organization and spent almost 10 years raising money, providing strategic assistance, and on-the-ground evaluation for potable water, microcredit, basic education, healthcare, sustainable agricultural type programs. And during that period, I learned two things that really stuck with me. And the first was that no matter how much money we raised, we were able to grow at 20% per year over in 9 years, but no matter how much more money we raised every year, we were always scrambling to raise funds for a couple of projects that just because of the countries they were in, you know, they weren't as attractive to donors, and they were worthy programs, but you still couldn't, you know, get funding for them. So, you know, first lesson to me was donor dollars will never be enough to solve the world's, you know, socioeconomic problems. And the second thing I learned supporting microfinance organizations was that what gets people out of poverty isn't the ability to get loans, because ultimately that just puts you in debt. It's the capability to get the loan to generate more income and then save that income. And if you're working through NGOs, they are legally not allowed to take savings. Only registered financial institutions that are, you know, undergoing oversight by banking superintendency in their country will be able to really take offer significant savings products. So that made me understand the importance of the commercialization of microfinance, and not work through NGOs, but work through formally regulated microfinance institutions that can attract greater sources of commercial capital and hopefully be able to reach more unbanked communities. So this job is really a blend of my two loves, being able to support development in emerging markets and do it using my financial background and skills. And with that, I'll be happy to pass my the baton over to Deborah.
Thank you, Joan. And it's a pleasure to be here and to have my three colleagues, all of us graduating the same year working in microfinance. I am going to bring my screen up and 1 second. Can everyone see that? I just have to put it on slideshow.
Yep.
Okay, hold on one, bear with me 1 second. Okay, great. Well, welcome everyone. I'm really glad to see the interest in microfinance, and I will also give you a little overview of ACCION International and then my career path. I'm going with the assumption that you wouldn't be dialing into this if you weren't interested in some form or knew a little bit about microfinance. So let me just start off by saying that, telling you a little bit about ACCION. It is a private nonprofit organization that has been in place since 1965. It was started as a private Peace Corps in Latin America. And it's working in Venezuela and eventually evolved into an organization focusing solely on microcredit, working initially in Latin America and now working throughout the world. And basically through providing microloans and financial services and business training to poor men and women to start their own business, ACCION and partner organizations and others like Women's World Banking help people to really work their way up the economic ladder with dignity and pride. We have a global presence now. When I started in ACCION, that is 19 years ago, we were working only, as I said, in Latin America and then started to work in the United States, where we continue to work in 6 different locations. And now are working with 32 microfinance partners in 23 countries. We are a network association, so we do not own many of the institutions that are part of our network, but often play a role and have equity investments in those institutions, the majority of which are now either banks or credit unions or finance companies, but regulated institutions that, as Joan mentioned earlier, allow microfinance clients to actually make deposits legally. We serve 3.7 million clients and, you know, continue to grow strongly and focusing in areas. Right now the strategy is to really focus in some large countries that have been underserved by microfinance over the years, places such as Brazil and China. The main approach of ACCION, it's what they really do call the commercialization approach to microfinance, if you get into the theory of it, but really that we very, very strongly believe in building sustainable commercial microfinance programs, and the key really is sustainable. In the past, microfinance was viewed much as a donor-driven philanthropic initiative in which donations were provided to grow the institutions. But the approach that is really that really all of us take in microfinance now is that it can be sustainable. It's the only way to permanently try to alleviate poverty, and that means basically being able to cover all the costs of your organization, your institution's operations, and which will allow you by charging interest rates, which will allow you to cover your costs and grow your organization so that you can reach more and more needy people. What do we do through this approach? You can see here we build and expand our MFIs. That can include launching and growing banks for the poor, strengthening microfinance operations, developing business plans. It really goes, it's not just making loans. I think the point of this slide is to show that you need all types of skills and people to grow this industry and to strengthen the industry. We conduct market research into looking for new kinds of products to meet the needs of the poor. Not only can save and use loans effectively, but they have all the same financial needs that you and I have for ourselves and our families and our businesses. We do provide strategic governance through sitting on the boards of the institutions that are part of our network, and we provide business development training and financial literacy education for micro-entrepreneurs. And we do that through these areas. I have these up here, the approach, to kind of show you again the skills that are needed. You know, if you think about, okay, what if I'm interested in microfinance, what kind of skills are really in need? I mean, 19 years ago when I joined, you really had to have spent a number of years in a developing country. You needed to be fluent in the language. But all of these general areas here that you see, market research and product development, I mean, that was not necessarily a skill that microfinance institutions were looking for at the time. Now this is key, the ability to do market research and product development. Obviously on the financial side, as Joan was alluding to, there's been a great deal of investment done, so there's a need for financial professionals, governance, and capital markets, as you see here. But we work in all of those areas with our microfinance partners. And on the capital market side, which is the area that I've been working in throughout most of my career at ACCION, we invest in projects that really foster better financial infrastructure. And that can be done in several ways. This is just a handful of some of the activities that we do at ACCION, by offering ACCION equity financing through our own private equity fund, as well as other funds that we manage. We have provided guarantee financing since 1986 through our bridge funds that have been very successful in leveraging commercial bank funding on a local basis to microfinance institutions, coordinating the Council of Microfinance Equity Funds, which is an association of equity funds that are investing directly in microfinance institutions, and training microfinance managers on how to prepare to receive investment, since many of these microfinance, if not all of them, 15 years ago were essentially nonprofit organizations and were working primarily from donations and eventually with loans. Microfinance institutions did not understand necessarily what it meant to actually have equity investments. So we helped to work in the area of investment readiness and innovative investing for our strategic investment groups. Finally, we're also involved at ACCION, and this is the area where I'm currently involved at the Center for Financial Inclusion, which really works on behalf of the microfinance industry as a whole, serving as a bridge to leverage private sector interest in microfinance. Of the three areas that you see that we focus at the Center for Financial Inclusion, I run the area of investing inclusive finance, which it is exploring the challenges and opportunities associated with the intersection of microfinance and commercial investment, including the Council of Microfinance Equity Fund and Investment Readiness, but it really is an outcome-focused organization working in collaboration with all of the industry players. So we try to bring the best minds and expertise to bear on the industry problems of financial inclusion. A little bit about my background. You can tell I've been at ACCION for a long time. I was always interested in Georgetown when I was at the Foreign Service School in international development. Never really planned to go into banking at all, never interviewed when I was graduating, but eventually ended up in a training program of a commercial bank after spending some time in Latin America, and then moved over to the World Bank when the World Bank started hiring bankers in the mid to late 80s. And then from there, when microfinance was merely a topic to discuss at brown bag lunches at the World Bank, for those of us working in the financial sector area, I moved on to ACCION. So never in my wildest dreams would I have believed that the World Bank and others would have been involved in microfinance to the extent they are. And you know, many people ask me, why have you been at ACCION so long? Well, with the evolution of the microfinance industry, there have been so many different opportunities to really experience and get involved with affecting some, you know, affecting some substantial change, I think, and really helping to grow the industry. So I've always worked mostly in the financial sector area, working in the guarantees and the different investments, but also, you know, on the ground working with practitioners. So I think for those of us who, you know, went to Georgetown and, you know, really wanted to be involved in international, it really is the perfect blend of using skills that, you know, we may have learned in the financial sector and really putting them to use for in social enterprises. So I want to thank you and now turn it over to Mary Ellen.
Okay, oops. Let's see. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm launching the wrong thing here. Give me just 1 minute. Okay,
sure.
There we go. Okay. Well, hello everybody. This is my inaugural webinar. I'm very excited to participate in it and realize just how easy this actually is. I do think the success in microfinance must have something to do with getting up for 8:15 language classes and trudging across campus to the School of Foreign Service. And I know very, very well that that's what Deborah was doing since we were on the same floor of St. Mary's dorm our freshman year, and we were getting up in the dark and going to those early morning classes while our nursing school roommates slept in. So I think that must be a prerequisite of success. But having said that, I'd like to just say a few words about WWB. Yes.
I'm sorry. Do you have your slides up yet?
I do.
Okay. We haven't seen them just yet, so.
Oh, really?
Nope.
Okay. People have a right when ready click the show my screen button.
Yep.
Maybe I'd have done
that.
Maybe
yep.
That's what I need to do.
That'd be great. There we go. Perfect.
Is that it? Okay. Sorry.
No
sorry.
Problem.
Okay. All right. Maybe it is harder than I had thought. let's see. Okay. So I'm going to advance to the next slide, I hope. There we go. Okay, to tell you a little bit about Women's World Banking, like ACCION, we are a networked organization, one that brings a very diverse range of microfinance providers and banks developing countries, 29 countries to be exact, together. But we're really united around a single common goal of providing access to finance to low-income entrepreneurs and their households and families, but with a special focus on women and making sure that women continue to be a central focus of microfinance institutions, even as the sector changes very, very dramatically. And we provide a range of services to our network members, but always with a focus on making sure that the product delivery and the way in which we are reaching out to them and they in turn to their clients takes into consideration women's motivations and needs and desires, which are very often quite different from those of men in the financial arena. We have a global footprint with institutions throughout the developing world, and our headquarters is in New York, where I am also based. As I mentioned before, our mission is very explicitly focused on low-income women, and then just to give you a little bit of a sense of the impact that we have through our 41 microfinance network members, 74% of our clients are women, and the total outstanding loan portfolio is $4.2 billion. This average loan size of $955 is actually significantly higher than it was even a year ago, in that WWB has undergone a fairly extensive restructuring of our network and actively brought into the network to provide these technical assistance services to several commercial banks operating in our member countries that are still not only committed to microfinance, but particularly to women clients. But banks that are operating in the microfinance sector tend to offer larger loans, and so on average our loan size has increased. That's something we pay a lot of attention to, since there does tend to be a close correlation between lower loan size and loans to women. So that's something that we're quite focused on with many of our network members. Maybe just to say a few words about the sort of current strategy that we're operating around. As I mentioned before, our central focus is to be the preeminent voice for women in microfinance, and then a range of other programs in terms of expanding our outreach and going to more underserved markets. We've been particularly focused in that regard in sub-Saharan Africa, expanding our footprint there, as well as the Middle East, where we see an enormous empowerment impact for women as they're able to take advantage of microfinance and other financial services, but making sure that we're not just growing numbers or growing institutions, but making sure that we are really having as deep an impact on our network members and their clients as possible. I think WWB and ACCION both have had quite a reputation over our histories. Women's World Banking is 30 years old this year, of being able to convene the industry around cutting-edge issues and concerns in the industry, and so we wanted to really leverage that capacity. So we hold a lot of industry events as well as events strictly from our network, but I think the strongest and most powerful part of being a network is the ability that our network members themselves have to learn from each other, and so that we're not just talking about fly-in, fly-out advisory services from consultants based in New York, but that the practitioners themselves can learn from each other and what has worked in one environment that might be adaptable to another. And then lastly, given that I was the first new president of Women's World Banking in 16 years when I joined in 2006, I really wanted to focus on building a sustainable, high-performance organization, again, as the industry has changed so dramatically in recent years. And the way that we've gone about doing this little building structure here is kind of the pictorial of our strategy. Everything focused, falling under the focus on women as clients, but also as leaders within the industry. We've seen, as the industry has become more commercial, that the number of women sitting on boards, in senior management positions, and even as loan officers of microfinance institutions has fallen off fairly drastically. And so that's something that we're really working hard to make sure that a diversity of leadership within microfinance is maintained. And so that first pillar is where our leadership development falls, and then some of the market research work that I mentioned earlier, which is really the first step in any product development that we do, is to really understand what are the motivations of our clients, particularly women. And then that work folds into that middle pillar. We're focusing on a greater diversification of products away from the the basic or in addition to the basic, you know, group loan that we all think of when we think of the early days of microfinance, to a broader range of other types of loans, such as rural lending or housing improvement loans. The big game changer in microfinance, as more institutions, as Deborah mentioned, are becoming regulated financial institutions, the ability for them to take savings deposits is a tremendous shift in the industry and one that we're very excited about. And then similarly, in the way that we're helping our clients, our network members' clients, build assets, we're helping them protect those assets by offering a range of insurance products through our network members, but with a particular focus on health insurance, since healthcare costs fall disproportionately on the shoulders of women in a household, and unanticipated healthcare emergencies are the single greatest cause for women's businesses to be decapitalized. And so finding other social nets solutions is a very important part of their being able to maintain their businesses. And then finally, again, as Deborah mentioned, the capital markets involvement of in microfinance is very, very exciting. And while we saw some drop off in this last year with the financial crisis, there's still tremendous interest on the part of commercial investors, and Women's World Banking has a team of, I refer to them as my recovering bankers, but a team of investment bankers and commercial bankers who work very closely with our network members to make sure that they are accessing credit on good terms and wherever possible in local currency, since they are, it's really an undue risk for them to be taking on the foreign currency risk as well. And then everything is sort of underpinned by knowledge dissemination. We view our work as really a public good, and so we try to publish everything or as much of what we learn as possible, and then building the relationships both from sort of New York out to the network as well as amongst the network itself. So that's really who we are as Women's World Banking. And then just this last slide maybe tells you infinitely more than you'd want to know about me, but I left Georgetown and was a foreign exchange trader at the Bank of America for 3 years, where I learned many interesting things, but I really learned how to swear very well there. I think that was a very important skill that I picked up on the trading floor and has stood me in good stead ever since, and then went on to the Yale School of Management because they did have a particular focus on training managers and leaders for all three sectors, the nonprofit sector, the public sector, and the private sector, and I did envision at the time a career that would have a span in all three sectors. When I graduated from Yale, I went to Lehman Brothers and got a very, very boot camp-like introduction to the world of investment banking that I've never regretted, but I did realize pretty early on that it really wasn't a career that was entirely consistent with my values, and while I knew I could apply the skills and the background and the facility with finance that I gained at Lehman, I really wanted it to serve some other higher purpose. And so I, too, went to the World Bank. Specifically, I was at the International Finance Corporation, the private sector arm of the bank, and had a long career there, 17 years there. And that was really where I first came into contact with microfinance. I first worked with ACCION there, actually, as well, and really saw the enormous power in Eastern Europe, in India, in Latin America, that even very small amounts of capital could have on people's lives. And so when I was recruited, headhunted for the WWB job, it just seemed like an enormous opportunity to really take an organization that had a great brand and a great reputation and move it into this next generation of the industry. And it was a tremendous leadership challenge for me. It was a CEO position that I had not yet held, and WWB is a nonprofit small organization in comparison to the big unwieldy World Bank bureaucracy. So it was a very, very different set of leadership talents and skills, and I have had really the time of my life and really do have a sense of being in the right time at the right place here at Women's World Banking. So I am delighted to take questions and delighted to see so many of you showed up for the call. So thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, ladies. That was wonderful. And I will get us started on our next question, and actually our first question. The first one asks, how are the loan sizes so large? Are those for groups of women or individuals, or how large are the groups of women who are getting loans?
Was this to me, or?
I think this question came in right in this last, yes.
Okay. That average loan size of just under $1,000 refers to individual loans made to individual women. And I believe in most of the microfinance models, and Joan and Deborah may know of, the way it might work in some other places, but average loan size typically refers to the loan made to an individual, although the methodology that is sometimes employed is to lend to all of the people in a group, and then in some instances, particularly there's a South Asian model that was pioneered by Grameen Bank, you would have the different members of the group counter-guaranteeing each other's loan. But the individual loans are usually what's referred to when we talk about loan size.
Great. Several of you have talked about your private sector experience previous to coming into this niche industry. Can you talk a little bit about what you found most valuable as far as skills that you could bring from that sector to this microfinance career field? Any one of you can answer that, actually.
I think it should be one of the other two.
Well, this is Joan, and I'll be happy to answer that. The nonprofit and for-profit business models, I think, are blending. Now we expect that nonprofits will run themselves efficiently, and hopefully will even produce an excess of revenue. It just won't be distributed to shareholders. It will be reinvested into programs. And on the other hand, we've seen this tremendous shift in the corporate world towards what you see referred to as corporate social responsibility. They all have the company foundations. They encourage their employees to serve on boards or to volunteer for organizations. To be able to understand the idiosyncrasies of both worlds, I think, is quite helpful because that profit motive is much more apparent and implicit in the for-profit world, and being always focused on, I think, being customer-driven is another attribute that can inform how a nonprofit organization serves its constituencies. And so, like some of the hard financial services, some of the customer relations issues, and then some of the marketing issues. I think a lot of nonprofits do a great job doing work on the ground, but don't necessarily tell their story well. And so, having seen how a for-profit company brands itself and presents its brand in the marketplace, I think is tremendously useful as a knowledge transfer to the nonprofit world.
And this is Deborah. I would add to what Jen said. In terms of skills from the private sector, the corporate sector, a lot of those skills really didn't exist in any sort of formal way in microfinance institutions, particularly 15 years ago. So I think coming from the banking sector, even an understanding of how bank operations worked was of incredible use to these institutions that were trying to change from being nonprofit to some kind of regulated institution. And that kind of knowledge, which you sort of take for granted when you're working inside of an institution, let's say a bank, is very hard to understand if you're someone who's inside the nonprofit working for a long time. So I think bringing skills that may seem commonplace from your corporate tech is actually exactly the kind of perspective and skills that are needed. And particularly now, as microfinance has become very competitive, issues related to operational efficiency are key. And that's where the skills and knowledge that you bring from the corporate sector are incredibly useful, along with the product knowledge.
Great, thank you. Mary Ellen, this is a follow-up question for you. Aren't the loan sizes about $50 is more common? How is $995 the average? Does that mean it is common for functioning businesses to acquire loans, or is this a startup cost?
No, actually, 50, I'm afraid, is actually becoming far less the case. The average loan size of the microfinance sector is moving into a couple of $100s. Up until we had brought these commercial banks in, our average loan size for many, many years hovered around the $500 mark. So I think that $50 loan that the questioner is asking about, actually we've kind of moved on beyond that. But as I said, I am concerned that it has moved to such a substantial amount. But I think it speaks to the growth of the businesses. It speaks to some economies or some geographies having larger loans. Eastern Europe tends to have from the get-go, this average size of a loan that's required to get a microenterprise up and running tends to be higher. So I think the questioner's sort of premise, I'm afraid, is not necessarily all that accurate any longer. We've seen a general move up in the average loan size. I don't know, Deborah, what is ACCION's average loan size?
I don't have the exact amount, but I mean, it probably is around what you're saying for women's rural banking. And I think it's important to note that one of the reasons why the average loan size has gone up is, as Mary Ellen just pointed out, really the globalization and the integration and the growth of the industry itself, reaching beyond South Asia, and the maturation of the industry in Latin America, meaning there was a theory, let's say 15 years ago, that microfinance clients were going to graduate to banks. And so, the microfinance institutions would be only working with, the startups and those that are just sort of entered into the market. That really has not been proven to be effective. So what you see when you see larger loan size is also the fact that, ACCION as well as Women's World Banking have clients that have been banking with the different microfinance institutions for over 20 years. So as one of the tenets of microfinance is to actually give people larger loans, as long as they have the capacity to repay, as an incentive. You have a lot of clients that have been with a particular microfinance institution for a very long time and have larger loans because their businesses have grown. So the average loan size is a bit deceptive because of all the different facets that are really involved in reflecting the evolution of the industry.
Great, thank you. Our next question is actually directed at the three of you. It says, is there a lot of travel in these underdeveloped countries by members of your organization? And the second part of this question is, how important is having an MBA in finance in joining organizations focusing on microfinance?
Well, I can answer this, Deborah. I mean, there can be a lot of travel depending on what position you are in. I think more and more organizations like Women's Rural Banking and ACCION are using staff in overseas positions, trying to be as local as possible. But those that are based in the U.S. or elsewhere, whether it be in Europe, do a fair amount of traveling depending on the type of work that you're doing. If you're someone making investments, you need to be on the ground doing the due diligence or attending the board meetings, which in some countries can be, on a monthly basis, or if you're providing technical assistance. But there are plenty of other positions that do not require that same level of travel. So it does depend. In terms of the use of an MBA, I would certainly say that we have recruited many, many more MBAs than we have in the past, and that reflects to some extent the increasing importance that investing has taken on within ACCION, and the increasing number of funds that we are managing. So we do need people with those skills. But I would actually say the MBA is also very attractive in the area of marketing and product development. But I do want to emphasize, even though I have an MBA that I got not so long ago, you do not have to have an MBA to get into microfinance. There are plenty of other skills that it obviously is attractive depending on the area of microfinance that you want to go into.
Great, thank you.
Mary Ellen or Joan, do you have any thoughts?
This is Joan, and I agree with what Deborah is saying. I think work and living abroad experience in an emerging market country is really important too, because you understand the framework, you know, the socio-political economic structures prevalent in the emerging world. And having just general finance skills, if you want to go into microfinance, is important. So an MBA would be great, but if you have worked for a bank and if you've got that overseas, you know, living experience, I think you're going to be in pretty good shape. Language skills are also very important. As microfinance expands into more and more countries, you know, it's grown very much in Eastern Europe. There's a strong push toward microfinance in China. So those are other skills that I think would also, you know, stand you in good stead for this industry.
Great.
I would just echo a lot of what the two of them said. If Joan hadn't said about the experience either living or at least working in developing countries, I think that's the few people that we've hired directly from, you know, with really strong marketing backgrounds who had MBAs and were coming directly from the for-profit sector but didn't necessarily have the emerging markets experience, I think has had quite a shock. So I would say those two, that combination of skills is ideal.
Great. Joan, does your organization have any relationships with the local universities for research or implementation?
Good question. We do a lot of information sharing with NYU. New York University has a Center for Financial Inclusion, so we, I think it's called Financial Access Initiative, and that is a great, you know, kind of research think tank place. So we've talked about research ideas back and forth, and, you know, we help each other out. We post their stuff on our website. Where we have a lot of, we have, you know, been asked to go and present at university classes. So there are increasingly microfinance courses in the curriculum. I think Georgetown has a microfinance course as well. So IAMFI is thrilled to go and speak with students. And we found great interns for IAMFI through Columbia University principally, and to a lesser extent NYU. So that's kind of been IAMFI's outreach to the universities in the New York area.
Great, thank you. The next question asks, how does your organizations measure performance outcomes with specific indicators? What specific indicators do you use? So for each of you, what kinds of organization measures are you using?
Well, that's really a conversation that could go on for hours.
Yeah, exactly.
That's why I'm hesitating. I mean, ACCION is, as is Women's World Banking, quite a large, multifaceted organization. So there is that we do have sort of dashboard indicators for our board, but every area within the organization has its measurements of success. So if I'm speaking in terms of the work that we do at the Center for Financial Inclusion, you know, we have been embarked on a campaign for consumer protection in microfinance. So, you know, we would measure our success by the number of people who have endorsed this campaign. So, I mean, the general ones for microfinance are often, you know, driven by, you know, number of clients or number of members of your network or average loan size, but it depends on if you're measuring financial performance and or your social impact. And since all of us are basically operating with double bottom line organizations, we have a combination of both social performance, or which is related to social impact, you know, how many women or what level of poverty are we reaching. Although all of these are very difficult to measure if in terms of universal measurements, we're all working towards that now. But we also would be measuring ourselves as well by, you know, our own level of sustainability as an organization.
Great, thank you. Mary Ellen, would you be able to address the question about is there a lower default rate on loans made to women, and what is the typical default rate overall?
Well, you know, it's been very interesting. Up until this last crisis, we have not seen dramatic differences in repayment rates. I mean, literally, you were talking on average maybe a couple of percentage points or basis points, not even percentage points, basis points difference between men's repayment and women's repayment. And I think that a lot of that goes to the just the general lack of access of all low-income borrowers, that they are, you know, we see it time and time again, and we've seen it to some degree in this crisis as well, that they will go to great extremes. They will make choices, food versus, you know, putting food on the table versus repaying the loan in order to stay in good stead with the microfinance institution. Interestingly, though, we have started to see, at least in the first, you know, we're getting on to a, you know, close to a year of the financial crisis, we have seen more of a disparity in the repayment rates between male clients and female clients. Again, it might have something to do with business size. Women's businesses tend to be smaller than men's, and so where we are starting to see, you know, some cracks in the fine lines here with microfinance institutions has been where borrowers may have borrowed more than one loan, or from different institutions, and now are getting themselves maybe in over their heads, and perhaps a larger business, you know, needed that additional capital. Then that would account for, you know, the man's business encountering more of a problem. But we've seen in general the repayment rates of, you know, roughly 97-98%. Have come off. You've seen some regions more hard hit than others. And, you know, interestingly, I don't know what this says about globalization, but it has been the regions that have been more integrated into the larger global economy. I think Eastern Europe has probably had the hardest hit portfolio quality problems in this time of crisis, but they believe, the institutions, at least in our network in that region, believe that, you know, they've hit a bottom and are coming back. But the repayment rates, nonetheless, are still far better than you've seen in the commercial banking sector, and certainly way, way better than, say, the credit card sector.
Great, thank you. The next two questions are actually related to the career path of microfinance. What would you recommend as a career path for recent graduates interested in microfinance?
I don't know. I guess this is Mary Ellen. I kind of see two real paths. I think getting the on-the-ground experience can be, you know, absolutely invaluable. On the other hand, and perhaps this shows my bias, getting a broader set of financial services skills under your belt, and sort of knowing how marketing, pricing, finance, systems, management work in the sort of more mainstream financial sector, and then applying that to microfinance, can at least here at around WWB and the people that we're increasingly bringing in as the industry becomes more aligned with the mainstream, you know, also can be a very, very profitable path to follow. I guess the one thing that I would just say, and maybe this is again one of my biases, is like getting experience writing well and writing something other than just like a PowerPoint presentation is something that I wish everyone who walked through our door had under their belt. There just seems to be a real dearth of writing capacity out there, and so that would be my only plea for one skill that I'd love to see developed more in the sector.
I would echo that completely. This is Deborah. There really are not a lot of really good writers out there, and I think part of what all of us try to do, and Mary Ellen talked about it a little bit, is you know, really provide to the industry lessons learned and actually, you know, disseminate the knowledge and the experiences that have happened. And it is very hard to get people with good, strong writing skills. So the one career path I would say, I mean, depending on what you're coming out of and what degree, I mean, ACCION has often been a very good place for people to go and spend a few years, particularly in the communications area, really writing and learning. It's like an immersion into microfinance, of learning about the industry or even in resource development. It's not so simple to walk out of any undergraduate situation and into a sort of investment type or even program related job these days, just as the industry has evolved and grown so much. So there are people are much more specialized. But I think the path that Marilyn mentioned is, I mean, I would echo what she said, but if you're, you know, one option also is to go in and really learn as much as you can in a writing role or a support role, and then potentially, you know, go on and study elsewhere or go, you know, get experience in the private sector. So I think we've seen both of them at ACCION. You know, the going in, though, initially right out of school often does mean that you may not be able to progress as quickly into, let's say, a more specialized functionary world just because of the fact that there are so many people going on to get MBAs and there's more competition and interest in the sector.
Thank you. Deborah, I'm going to direct this question at you. The person says, in Thailand, where I live and work, microfinance institutions are still not legal, but organizations working in development and poverty alleviation are working to change this. How has the microfinance industry supported changes in legal structures in countries where you're operating, and what strategies have you seen most effective?
Now, it's a very, very good question and absolutely key to the success of what all of us are trying to do here, whether it's purely investment work because you need to have a well-functioning stock market to actually, you know, exit from investments, to the work that, you know, Women's World Banking and ACCION have been trying to do in growing and strengthening institutions. We have done a lot of work at ACCION over the years, and Women's World Banking has as well, in talking to policymakers, and more from, I'd say, an educational perspective, having to help them understand what microfinance is, particularly if their institutions are becoming regulated, understanding what that means, and really in an advisory capacity, where it's been most effective, in my personal opinion, is when this role of working with governments through whether committee or associations has been done in conjunction with players like the World Bank and others that actually can bring the stick and the carrot to have people sort of pay attention. So, you know, we've done a lot of work in the area of supervision and regulation, working with the decision makers and policy makers, holding forums or you know, convening meetings, and then CGAP, which is part of the which is the arm of the World Bank that works with microfinance, has their policy experts working right alongside the actual policymakers in the country to either bring to bear the best practices or bring people that have, you know, from other countries, but to actually change it. And, you know, it works. In a lot of cases, there have been a lot of successes in other countries. It's been much more difficult just for reasons of, you know, constantly changing, you know, policies and constantly changing people rotating in and out of the different agencies.
Great, thank you. And for our last question as we wrap up here today, Joe, maybe you can start to answer this one for us. What do you see as the biggest challenge in the growth of microfinance in this industry over the next 5 to 10 years? So, and then we'll just go down the line and wrap up.
Very good. I think the big challenge for the microfinance industry is to help more of the MFIs, the microfinance institutions operating on the ground, to become more investable. The industry estimates are that there are about $30 billion invested in microfinance to date, but if you take the number of people living below $2,000 a day, take the economically active population or working age population out of that and multiply it by, you know, some average loan size, which I have seen most recently as being at $600, you know, you end up needing about $300 billion. So we currently have a $270 billion funding gap. And there are two challenges. One is helping educate investors so that they understand microfinance investing better, creating more transparency in microfinance investment, getting more deal standardization, building basic investor services like having a secondary market, having, you know, investment exit options. But on the flip side, there's an absorptive capacity challenge, which is that of the approximately 10,000 organizations around the world that are doing some form of microfinance, only an estimated 200 to 250 are currently eligible for investment, are able to take investment. Since investors are looking for strong governance, you know, strong financial management, good internal controls, and also an enabling, you know, economic or political environment. So the double challenges are, on one hand, helping more of the MFIs become investor ready, and Deborah's and Mary Allen's organizations are doing a tremendous job supporting MFIs to help them be able to take on more capital, build their loan portfolios and other financial services to meet clients' needs. And the second challenge is creating a more supportive, you know, legal, fiscal, regulatory structure in the countries where microfinance is operating on the ground, and then building more product options and more you know, accountability and standardization and transparency for microfinance investors. Right now, outside of a couple of retail options, you have to be an accredited investor to be able to even invest in microfinance. So I think those are the two challenges that I see on the landscape.
Mary Ellen or Deborah, you would like to share on that question?
This is Deborah. I mean, I think to me the challenge really is understanding, I mean, are we, how are we advancing towards full financial inclusion, and really making sure that we are meeting the needs of clients that we serve? And I think part of that is really working much more strongly on the area of deposit mobilization. And the other challenge is, you know, is really understanding the future of microfinance may not be only in microfinance institutions, but may be through technology. There may be people that we can't reach through actual brick and mortar institutions, but we can reach through technology. And I think that's a huge challenge in terms of making the industry more efficient, but yet really reaching out and reaching many, many more people than we're touching now with the products and services that they truly need and want.
I would absolutely salute this last view, and I am quite concerned about microfinance becoming sort of a victim of its own success, and as it attracts more and more attention and more capital and more interest, that we may run the risk of moving away from the intended initial clients. But I guess the only thing I would sort of add in response to the direct question that we were asked is I do worry about human capital and human capacity within the microfinance sector, and that is part of why this whole leadership effort on our part, on Women's World Banking's part, has become such a priority area for us. We're seeing in so many of our institutions where we've had extraordinary growth rates, and even in this time of crisis, we're going to see positive growth. It may be slower than it has been in the last few years, but there is still considerable growth, and yet being able to attract and retain talent. Very often, microfinance institutions are competing against mainstream, much larger, much more, you know, flush financial institutions in their local market for talent, and then making certain that that talent not only is diverse and brings a wealth of different perspectives to leadership, but that it truly understands the double bottom line, and that if we're just sort of hiring away other bankers to fill vacant positions, are they going to be, you know, fully cognizant and fully bought into that important social mission that I think has characterized microfinance to date?
Great. Thank you so much, Joan, Mary Ellen, and Deborah, for joining us and presenting with us today. I want to thank everyone who has joined in and asked questions and made it a very dynamic conversation. Thank you, everyone, for participating. On your screen is our upcoming webinar. Feel free to check out our website for more programming and events that are coming up for networking at alumni.georgetown.edu/careerservices. And I hope everyone has a great day. And thank you again, ladies, for a great presentation.
Thank you, Maisha. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
Have a great day.
Bye-bye.